let's now move to the third P. Be proactive. The ability of learners to project themselves socially and emotionally in an online environment is not a given. Being able to create and sustain the right environment here will be a crucial aspect of a student's learning journey. The guiding question of this lesson is how to ensure this being proactive, this time focusing on the asynchronous setting. The learning portfolio is a good instrument to activate engagement towards the learning material. You may be wondering, what is a learning portfolio exactly? A learning portfolio is a collection of your work as a student. It aims to exhibit your effort, progress, achievement, and competences gained during a course or certain time period. This allows your students to go through three very important steps. The first one is reflection, during and after your learning process. As a learner, it is crucial to actively engage with the content from the very beginning. Do not just lay back and listen to the content, but find your way to be proactive about it. This is the first step out of the consumption attitude that can define the online environment, as we saw. You can take notes while listening or draw a map of the main concept the instructor is talking about. Find your own strategy here. It doesn't really matter what you do, as long as it allows you to interact with the content from the very beginning. Reflection is fundamental for the learning process and also a way to summarize what you have achieved after moving on with the next unit or course. The second important function of a learning portfolio practice is that it allows you to share your progress with your learning community, which can have a huge impact on your motivation and performance. As we have seen before in the Teaching Online unit, many pedagogical theorists stress the importance of social interaction, not only to enhance the learning experience, but ultimately to perform better. One example of this is social constructivism, a sociological theory suggesting that each individual learns as a result of social interaction and collaboration with others. If you want to learn more about this theory, we have provided you with some references in this unit. As an online learner, you will have many ways to share ideas and knowledge in a collaborative space. Forum, chats, online study groups, a digital classroom. But they are only as effective as you and your fellow learners make them. Why don't you start now by making a comment in the forum? Finally, collecting your achievement and tracking your progress is the most obvious function of a learning portfolio. This, of course, has many advantages for you and your students, besides the reflection and sharing ones that we just talked about. For example, a learning portfolio can become an alternative form of documentation to showcase your skills, your motivation, and your educational process. This is, of course, useful for everyone, but especially to the students that have no simple way to directly prove their competency. Refugee students from countries whose educational systems are not immediately translatable or recognized by Western universities, for instance. Digital tools can be very supportive of this process, allowing you to not only track your final achievement in a traditional way, but also collect any sort of alternative badge, showing, for example, perseverance or growth over time, for instance, the way you're collecting badges in this course. To quote many studies on the topic, learning portfolios are like a window into a student's metacognitive process. Let's now talk about the fourth and last P, be personalized. If you're into education, you've probably heard of Sir Ken Robinson, professor, author, and advocate for education reform. He is originally from Britain and quite a funny guy. He is famous for giving several talks about radically innovating education, filled with dry, self-deprecating British humor, which are very, very entertaining. We recommend you to watch some of them if you haven't already. You'll find a link to one of our additional resources. Heterogeneity is often understood as a problem by conservative educators. Mass education secretly wishes to reduce diversity as much as possible, to profit from standardized, scalable plans, and not to have to deal with personalization. This approach comes from the time of Industrial Revolution, which produced the need of a very particular kind of citizen, who was disciplined, did what they were told, and memorized things. Basically, a factory worker. This is not the scenario we're confronted with anymore. This word has been, to use a very overused word, disrupted and tends towards change at an unprecedented speed. The point of Robinson's educational philosophy is that we need to put a strong emphasis on creativity in our educational system. We need to rethink the fundamental principle of education because the future is unpredictable, and standardized mass education kills the potential of the future generation to reinvent the world and deal with the challenges of tomorrow.
So our main question for personalization is, how can you best address the individual needs of your students? In other words, how can we foster that individual development and personalization for each of our students that Robinson is talking about if it means accommodating different learning styles, different learning paces, and different interests and motivations? Sounds like a lot of work for each student, right? Digital education is a great playground to address this problem. Students can put together their own curriculum online, focusing on their talents, their interests, skipping lectures they already feel confident in, and giving themselves more time to deepen their knowledge with material they don't feel so secure on. And they can come into contact with students from all walks of life and corners of the globe and become more interculturally aware. Student-centered approaches like problem-based learning are also likely to foster creativity and move away from that frontal, pre-constructed approach to knowledge. Students learn about a subject through the experience of solving an open-ended problem that they have to create a path to navigate, often using real-world scenarios, social learning environments, and the application of knowledge to new situations. A wide range of digital technologies can effectively support problem-based learning and encourage learners to develop creative thinking skills. We'll introduce you to some of these in our additional materials section.